Hi there, welcome to UI Hard Parts. I'm Will Sentence, CEO of Codesmith. Today we're going to build out an under-the-hood mental model of how user interfaces are built within the web browser. We're going to explore a minimal user interface using JavaScript, the DOM API, Event API, Web Core, and Web IDL within the web browser. In order to give structure to that code at scale, we're going to add one-way data binding as a strategy, but ensure that it's still performative even as we get composable UI with the help of a visual or virtual DOM, reconciliation based on a Diffing algorithm, and the introduction of state hooks. So I'm delighted to have you here for User Interface Hard Parts, and I look forward to seeing you in the course. Here's our web page, and we get to write in the beautiful language of HTML, we get to write code instructions that add things directly to a C++ list of elements. That's kind of amazing. And those are then auto-displayed, rendered through the layout and render engine. The layout part is going to analyze exactly how to place the elements that we list out on this particular web, particular web browser's screen, particular device. And then the pixels are going to be determined by the render engine. Actually, by the way, side note, the output of the render engine is going to be an image, a bitmap image of that particular view, that screen, pinged out to the graphics card every, 16 milliseconds, 60 times a second. Isn't that wild? This altogether is known as Web Core. This is the core set of technologies that do the job of storing a list of elements in C++ to be loaded on the web page and then converting that list into actual pixels. We do not get to write, well, we'll see, this C++. I don't know if I want to. I get to write the beautiful HTML, which allows me to list stuff down the page in order. Think about how intuitive that is. I want to add some text to the page. I write the text. I then want to add a box below it. I get to write the name of that box in the line below in my text file. Don't ever underestimate how thoughtfully designed that is. So let's get into it. Line one of our HTML, people. Little do you think you were coming to the hard parts of user interface engineering to walk through some HTML. Here we go. Line one. Why? What are we doing in our first line of HTML? What are we adding to our DOM in our first line?
Putting up some text.
So we've got what's on your mind. That's going to add to our list of elements, the text as our first element. What's on your mind? Beautiful, there it is. And that's then going to automatically display what's, if I write this one more time, what's on your mind on the page. Isn't that beautiful? There it is. Our next element on our list is going to add what, Phil?
Going to add an input
element. Input element. Yeah, they often call them on the DOM, the list of C++ elements, they often call it a node. A node on the DOM. But it's you can sort of think of this as an element, and an element on the page. An element in our HTML code, they often call these HTML tags. I wouldn't call these then tags. These become kind of nodes. I think the term element works kind of the whole way across. Yeah, input, that's going to add an input element. I'm actually going to literally show them as almost little bullet points kind of listed down. And there it is, my input field. Oh, that's not very nicely drawn. And then I get to add, and this is where we get to see our next elegantly designed feature of HTML. I love all of these people in this room have been explicitly, I've been told, are mid to senior level engineers. And every one of you is like, how do we get punished with this? So, but everything else we're gonna do, people, in hard parts is going to carry back to this goal. Everything else we do in UI hard parts is gonna try to make it as intuitive as this. So, there it is, button, and look at this. If I wanted to have, so let's produce a button. Okay, that makes sense. If I wanted to have some text inside of a button on a screen visually, that's my output is going to be a button with text inside of it. How would I write, how could I design my programming language, run the programming language designer, to make it as intuitive as possible to have text inside of something on the screen? Well, I'd have it that I write the text inside of button. I mean, I just, and there it is. We let it know the button's ending with a little forward slash, but I have text inside of a button. And so on my model of the page, I will have a button added, and then almost like a sort of nested, like a sub element, our text of publish. And then that will create publish, almost think like a sort of sub element, or a, if you were thinking about this in an array, if this were a list, it would be a sub array within the existing array. If it were an object, you imagine it sort of be a sub object reference from within an existing object. And that then shows up on the page accordingly. And now more user action comes. They click so they could start writing. And they start writing what they start writing, typing, sorry. It's got to be our friend. Why? There we are. And that is going to show up in the input field. And it's going to immediately show up on our DOM in that value position. If we're saying that everything the user sees needs to depend on underlying data, it ain't pretty that there's data here, there's data here. By the way, the CSS model of the page also can have data that determines what shows up on the page. In a sense, our HTML code was an initial population of data, only one time display of data, but it was, again, it's like, how do we have four different places to store data that can then determine what the user sees, and are at least three out of four of them are changeable? Well, that's why we're going to be really restrictive if we're actually going to have JavaScript as our single source of data, to the point that I won't even see this as necessarily data so much as a submission, because when that input is filled in, it's going to trigger the handle input function to be passed to the callback queue, where Ian, can you help me out? We're at like 1 minute and 1 millisecond, and handle input, because the user has typed their name, why? Handle input has now been added to the callback queue. What's going to happen in JavaScript?
Well, since it's in the callback queue, we're going to see, I mean, with the event loop, we're going to make sure that nothing is in the call stack.
Yep.
That it, well, except for the global function. And then we're going to execute. What do? We handled input, yes, because we typed Y.
Right, so exactly.
We are going to assign our piece of data post.
Oh, hold on. We're calling. We're going to execute handle input. So it's a new. Okay, you can do this, Ian. It's a new what?
Okay, it's a new execution context.
Yes, beautiful. Exactly. Brand new execution context. Exactly. Well done. Exactly. Into it we go. And you're right. The only thing we can do is update data.
Yes.
Tell me about it.
So we are going to take the piece of data called post.
Yep, or the identifier for a piece of data called post, yep.
Yes.
Yep.
And then we are going to assign it to the result of accessing the value property of JS input, but JS input is going to be a...
accessor
an
object.
An accessor object that we got. Because that we can't just get stuff from the DOM.
Yeah, because they're C++ objects. It's beautiful, Ian. It's wonderful.
So we're reading it from the DOM through that accessor object to get the value of the JS input.
Yes.
Assign post to that value.
Yes, so we grab it, and actually it's going to turn into a JavaScript string that we end up assigning there. Note, I'm now changing from green, which was a user submission, I'm going to call it, into saving it in white. It's a JavaScript string. There it is. That's great. And then we've changed data. That's all we did. And so, Ian, what are we now going to call?
We're going to call our function data2view.
Data2view converter. Brand new execution context. I call it a converter function, right? Because it converts our data into our view. Now, it might do it with a bunch of conditionals to determine exactly what to display, but its input is JavaScript data, and its output is view, is content the user sees. Into data to view converter we go. And John, if you don't mind, over to you. We are going to evaluate.
JS input that value set, et cetera, and we will check if post equals undefined. And because it's not equal to undefined, we will get pulse's value and set input's value to pulse's value.
In the DOM, exactly. And that is the string what?
Y.
And look, people, I've changed it to white. It is derived directly from our JavaScript data. That only would have shown us the green for a second. Oh, and that's going to, of course, mean that what the user sees, they think it's just what they typed. No, they're not to be trusted with that. They have to trust us to refill it with actual data from JavaScript. And then take it away, John.
And then we will call JSDiv's method, setter method text content.
Yeah, they call it property, but I'm with you. Setter method or prop, both work, but yeah, exactly.
Text content, and we will set it to post.
Yep, which is?
That equals to Y.
And that?
And we will go to DOM and set it.
Beautiful, the execution context closed. They're popped off the call stack. And look at that, people. We have a full user interface with a highly restrictive, but honestly liberating design pattern of everything the user can possibly see is an output of JavaScript data. We have one function that in any change to date, any change, any action from the user or inaction, the initial before the user takes any action from the user will only be allowed to affect change on JavaScript data, nowhere else. What a beautiful job, everybody. That is our update DOM function finished running. We exit our find div execution context. We exit our update DOM execution context. And we have made our changes and we got a beautiful, a beautiful description in JavaScript of what we wanted to display on the page with dynamic data. Imagine HTML, but you could have variables in it, which is what we're always trying to get to. You know, just that's what we've been trying to get to, punchline. Descriptive of what's going to show up on the page, but with data that can change. Because what are the two things user interface is trying to do? Display, one, what's the first thing?
Display content.
And two is to let the user
change
the content, change it, exactly, yeah, exactly. So we had with HTML beautiful techniques for displaying content. Put it on the page in the order you want to display in. If you want it inside of something on the page, put it inside of that stuff in the code. Display content was easy, but we didn't have any data. And there's no such thing as content being changed by the user's action and what they see changing without there being associated corresponding data. Unfortunately, that data lives in a totally different runtime, that of JavaScript. And the flow back and forth, particularly given there's also kind of persistent state here in the DOM, the flow back and forth was extremely hard to maintain mentally. So instead we said, one simple rule, users can only in the handlers update, or we as developers can only write code to update underlying data and then have a single function flow it through. Only think in terms of underlying data must describe all stuff the user sees must have corresponding underlying data such that we can see exactly where our consequences, exactly what our change is based and caused by the underlying data flowing through to the view. It's one way of providing that restriction that makes our code predictable. I know where my output on the page comes from. It's my single function running through from underlying data. I don't have to reason about if the user clicks on that, then swipes that, then given all those things, I'm gonna change. No. Just change data and based off that data, display content. Almost see it as a submission and then based off that, display it. What that also gave us was the ability to describe as an intermediary step in JavaScript what content we wanted to have displayed off that data. And we did exactly that with our visual or virtual DOM. it allowed us to only think in terms of one description and a bunch of conditional displaying of the underlying data, including whether or not to display divs, whether or not to display content. And then we realized we were still wiping our entire DOM as though we didn't have a full archivable history of what was actually going to be displayed on the page in our JavaScript, where we could then compare those two collections of elements with their instantiated data and decide what actually changed, which we did. And from that, Diffing, that algorithm that did the comparison, we only made the actual changes necessary to the real C++ elements. No performance issues. Finally, composable UI, that's not a disaster.